Hey guys, this is Patrick from STH. Today, we're going to talk about Compute Express Link, or CXL. Now, we've been covering CXL on STH since like 2019, and back then it was really one of those technologies that was a little bit further away. It was kind of hard to see being tangible. And today, we don't necessarily have the servers and devices that support CXL, but they're not far off. So while it's not in the Intel Ice Lake and also the AMD EPYC Milan series of processors, we do expect that CXL will be supported in the PCIe Gen 5 generation, which will come out in 2022. Or in other words, CXL is going to go from theoretical to basically the next generation of servers you're going to buy in less than a year. And because this is such an absolutely massive shift in the industry, what I thought would be a good idea would be to actually go through and give a high-level description and explain to folks what's going on with CXL, why we have it, and then give you a good example of why it is going to be completely game-changing. Now, we have a number of videos where I've already gone out and just basically said that CXL will mark a clear demarcation in like servers that came before CXL and servers that came after CXL. This is the biggest architectural shift that has happened in generations. And so I think it's super important that everybody understands it, which is hence why I wanted to make this reference guide. And at this point, you're probably wondering why I have a lime in my hand and there's also limes adorning this Sony FX3 camera over here. The reason for that is I wanted to come up with some way to easily conceptualize what in the heck is going on in CXL. So hopefully using this, if you don't get CXL based on the diagrams that are out there and all the technical descriptions and stuff like that, hopefully the delicious lime will be a good example and help you understand and remember what the different components of CXL are. Now, I admit this is totally a bit of a stretch, but the idea came to me while eating tacos and I love lime. So I said, let me challenge myself to see if I can make it work. And I think I got something that does work. So let's get to it. First off, what is CXL? CXL, I mentioned, is Compute Express Link, and it is a cache coherent interconnect that will help systems, especially those with accelerators, operate more efficiently. The first iterations of CXL will sit atop of the PCIe Gen 5 infrastructure. And what that practically means is that number one, we need to have PCIe Gen 5 devices to be able to enable CXL, but also you could have a CPU and that CPU will have, say, PCIe Gen 5, but an optional mode on certain devices will be that you can also utilize CXL. So you can think of it, a port will most likely always operate with PCIe Gen 5, but CXL will be an option that some devices, not all of them, will be able to take advantage of. Now, the industry actually got together, and what's really nice is that they said, okay, we're going to support the CXL thing, but we're also going to support PCIe Gen 5, and we're going to do it simultaneously. And that means that the switching can actually happen relatively transparent to users. And what that practically means is that your next generation of server processor, most likely you're going to have slots, and you can run that slot as either PCIe Gen 5 or CXL. And the best analogy I could come up with today's architectures is really if you look at AMD EPYC, where you have the PCIe lanes that can either operate as PCIe lanes or in a dual socket configuration, they can operate as Infinity Fabric. That's not a perfect analogy, but the same idea, it's conceptually similar to what basically happens. And while Infinity Fabric is really an AMD, so really a vendor specific implementation, CXL is designed to be really an industry wide standard. Really the key benefit of CXL is the fact that we can do load stores across different types of devices and memory classes. And it really changes the interaction of host CPUs and accelerators with memory in a system. You might wonder why I keep talking about memory. And one of the big reasons that CXL is even out there is really because of the hyperscalers. The hyperscalers realize that basically almost every single device that they have in a modern server has its own memory. When we talk about server memory, we often talk about the main memory that's attached to the host processors, but there's way more than that in a modern server. For example, SmartNICs often have their own memory or DPUs. You'll also see that you have GPUs, which of course have memory, and I think everybody sees, you know, memory on GPUs and kind of gets that idea. Even on the storage side, the SSDs that you have, if you have an NVMe SSD, for example, and it's a data center SSD, you're most likely going to have some sort of DRAM cache and DRAM in that SSD. So when you get to a point in a system where there's so many different sources of memory, what eventually will end up happening is that you'll start to see that it's not being used efficiently. Your SSD may have, say, 2 gigabytes of memory, but it's only using, say, 1 gigabyte of it at a given time. And so you have a gigabyte there. Your GPU may only be using, you know, a quarter of its total GPU memory. Your CPU may only be using maybe half of its memory. And once you multiply that by the number of devices, you're going to start seeing that you actually have a lot of stranded memory because every device basically has its own little memory pool and doesn't share. So CXL is basically a way to share. The basic idea is by sharing, we get better utilization because we have one larger pool or what's something that might look a little bit more like one larger pool. By getting more utilization, that means that we can either reduce the cost of our memory footprint in a server, or we can potentially just do more with that given hardware. Now we're going to talk about this whole CXL thing in the context of servers because that is really what the hyperscalers are looking at for the first generation of CXL. But at the same time, this can go well beyond servers and go to other classes of devices. It could even use it in a client PC. That's totally valid as well. It's just that you're going to see this probably first really hit the server mark. Now the idea of having higher utilization drive better efficiency will make a lot of sense to server folks. That's basically the entire idea of virtualization. So at this point, you might be saying, well, the hyperscalers have been doing this for years. The industry has been doing this for years. So why in the world are we waiting till PCIe Gen 5 to even really start on the CXL journey? And frankly, one of the biggest reasons there is just the fact that we had, if you take Intel Xeons, for example, Intel launched PCIe Gen 3 with Sandy Bridge in 2012, and they were still using PCIe Gen 3 on their flagship server processors in Q1 of 2021. It wasn't until Ice Lake in Q2 that we got PCIe Gen 4. And although Intel's going to PCIe Gen 4 in Q2 of 2021, we'll start to see PCIe Gen 5 about a year later. So we're seeing a massive uptick in terms of the PCIe link speeds. That massive uptick means that we can do more things because we have like 4 times as much bandwidth with PCIe Gen 5 as we had in PCIe Gen 3. Or another way to put it is that your PCIe Gen 3 GPU or your 100 gig NIC that was on PCIe Gen 3 by 16 slot, you can actually just run in a by 4 slot in the PCIe Gen 5 era. So part of it is that we just need the underlying technology to get faster. And the other thing is it just takes time to invent stuff. And that's basically the reason that we're waiting until PCIe Gen 5. And beyond just having the physical layer and then also the spec and the invention that is the CXL, then you also need everybody to go adopt it so that it becomes an industry standard. And so if this thing comes out in 2019, it takes a little bit of time for a lot of companies to say, okay, yeah, this is what we're going to go do. And then it takes a little while for that to go into products. So that way the products that are designed actually use CXL. That's like an important part of this. And the reason PCIe Gen 5 is so important is that we finally get enough bandwidth coming in at a fast enough clip, I guess, or a rate of improvement that's fast enough that we can actually start doing things that look more like memory transactions on PCIe because we have enough bandwidth to go do that. If you were to do that on PCIe Gen 3, well, that would look way too slow. So that's a good reason that we need PCIe Gen 5 for this. Okay, let's go to that next level of detail in terms of CXL and specifically what I call the protocol trifecta. And for that, we're going to start using our LIMEs. Now, the first protocol is actually CXL.io. And the easiest way to think about CXL.io is that this is really kind of that base link layer that describes the relationship of CXL devices. When you plug a CXL device in the system, you want things to happen like you want to have enumeration. You want to have the registration of that device in a system. You want it to initialize. You want it to have a link up event so that way it starts communicating with the system. And these are all just kind of those base functionalities, and that's really CXL.io. And so using our LIME analogy, I think the best way to think about this is, you know, you can have a LIME and that's kind of like a DIM or something like that. And CXL, sure, it's an LIME, it's absolutely great. But if you go throw this LIME into your drink, you're not going to get the pleasant citrus taste. Instead, it's just going to be kind of this big blob of thing that you're putting into your liquid. The reason for that is that you basically have this skin layer and you need to get under that to get to the actual citrus fruit. So what do? You cut the LIME open. Typically, we'll cut it in half or maybe in quarters or in eighths, kind of like how you have a by 16 device, a by 8 device, or by 4 device. Like I said, we're going to stretch a little bit for this LIME one, but that's probably the biggest one that we're going to do. Now, the next two are really the important ones in terms of thinking about how the direction of information and what the relationships are. The first one is CXL.cache. Now, CXL.cache really defines the interactions between like a host CPU and connected devices. And specifically, what this really is designed to do, and CXL cache is designed to do, is to allow devices to access host memory with low latency. So you can kind of think of this, and a really good example that a lot of the industry uses is if you had a SmartNIC or something like that, and you had data that was in host CPU memory, you maybe don't want to put a whole bunch of memory on that SmartNIC. So instead, what you want to do is go pull the memory and pull data from the host system memory. Now, in this example, we're going to use tacos to represent host CPUs, and we're going to use what we are going to call sodas as the idea of having a CXL device. So in this case, CXL cache is basically how a soda would end up getting the lime, which is our bit of memory, from the host CPU and start using the juice from that lime in the device, which is our soda. We're going to get to some examples. We're really going to talk a lot more about how we're going to use these lime examples, but it's just kind of setting up the frame. And when we talk about CXL cache, you can think about the lime that we're accessing, or the memory that we're accessing, really is sitting in the taco rather than in the device, which would basically be a soda. The third protocol is CXL.mem. And this is really kind of the exact opposite in a lot of ways. Now, there are a lot more technical details behind this that I urge you, if you're really interested in it, go look at it. But from a high level, you can kind of think of this as the opposite. So let's take a GPU, for example. You know that you have all that, say, high bandwidth memory, or you have all that memory that's on a GPU, but you may not use all that memory, or you may want the host CPU to directly access the memory that is in that GPU without having to do a transfer. And so to do that, what you have is CXL.mem, which allows the host CPU to go access the lime, which is, you know, our memory that sits in the device, which is our soda. So CXL.io defines how we are going to not use this giant lump of lime, but instead use only a cut of it. Well, CXL cache basically allows the taco's lime to be used by the soda, and CXL.mem allows the soda's lime to be accessed by the taco. And you may be thinking, wait a sec, that makes CXL.io. Why is that even exciting when the other ones actually do something that's useful? But just remember that if you don't have a CXL.io link happening, then you basically don't have a device that is on CXL. And so you need to have that as a base infrastructure. Now, that is really looking at this in terms of CXL 1.1. So these are really the devices that we're going to start seeing in 2022. But CXL 2.0 is already out. And what that brings is a awesome, absolutely awesome feature, which is really like CXL switching. What CXL switching allows you to do is basically have a switch, kind of like a PCIe switch, but then you can have multiple hosts, in our case, tacos, and you can also have multiple devices, which could be, you know, just simply the sodas, but it could also be all kinds of different devices. And you can have access on that switch between any of the hosts and devices. If you recall, the entire idea of this, or one of the big ideas of this, is the idea of being able to share resources or utilize resources more efficiently. And so using a CXL switch basically allows you to put a bigger pool of hardware together, which allows you then to go drive up the utilization rates. This is just like virtualization, where if you have a bigger virtualization node, you're often able to go and drive up your virtualization or number of VMs per system. And by having more VMs per system, you get less stranded resources. And that is basically a fundamental feature of the cloud. So let's get to a couple of examples and really show you how this whole thing, you can kind of conceptualize this whole thing. We're, of course, going to use our limes to represent memory. Our main dishes, which are going to be our host processors, are going to be represented by tacos. Specifically, we're going to use the Rubio's Mahi Mahi, or Black and Mahi Mahi taco, as well as street tacos. If you don't love fish tacos, you need to spend more time in Mexico, and specifically Baja California. We're then going to have beverages be our, say, accelerators. Now, our first example is something that if you go to Rubio's, and if you've ever been, you will have definitely experienced at some point, which is, well, we got two of these Black and Mahi Mahi tacos, but we only got one little lime to spread the juice on to the different tacos. Let's face it, sometimes when you have two tacos, you want two little lime slices because it's just easier to spread the lime juice. But let's say at the same time, when we got our beverage or our soda at Rubio's, we also got a lime in that. So we have two tacos. We need a little bit more memory because we don't have enough memory attached to those host processors, which are our tacos. And so what we're going to do is we're going to access the lime juice that came out of our beverage lime, and we're going to use that as our access to be able to get more lime juice for our second taco. Another option is that we could also just have a bunch of limes that are just sitting on the table, and we could use one of those limes. And that would be like a CXL device. We recently covered the Samsung memory expansion device, and this would be a good example of where you would attach that into a system. And then you have some extra lime, which is, think of this like that Samsung module, and you'd have that extra line to be able to store data that could be accessed by that host CPU. So you don't necessarily need to have two limes for two tacos. You could only have one lime for the tacos and then use the extra one that's just kind of sitting there on the cutting board. That is what CXL calls a type 3 device. Now, if you want to look at type 1, it's kind of the opposite of that, which is really, let's say that we had that one lime, but we decided, well, maybe, you know, maybe just for some reason today isn't a lime taco day. Instead, we want a lime in our beverage. So what if we take that lime that's in our host taco or host CPU and we utilize that lime juice for our beverage? So our beverage in that case might be something like a SmartNIC. That is basically the idea behind CXL cache and is really a type 1 device. So our first example was CXL.mem, second example, CXL.cache. And the way to remember it is just which device is accessing the limes. All right, but let's get to something that's a lot more exciting than just a couple of limes. In our third example, which is basically a type 2 example in CXL terminology, let's assume for a second that we had maybe different kinds of limes, or hey, let's get wild and maybe let's have a lemon. Or what if we had two varieties of lemons? That would be even more exciting. And so here you can see our cutting board full of limes and different kinds of lemons. And then what we can do is we can use the limes and lemons that are on that cutting board that are kind of that shared resource. And we can use the juices of those and we could potentially have a lemon go to a beverage or a lemon go to a taco, or we could have a lime or whatever we want to go do. That is really the power of combining all three protocols, CXL.io, MEM, and cache, all in a single system and design. Having that common plate of tacos is really more like having the CXL 2.0 switched example. And that's really where you're going to see the real power of this. You could just have whatever kind of citrus fruit that you want. And then you could squeeze out an entire lemon onto your taco or into your beverage. Or what you could do is you could squeeze a little bit of lemon in one beverage and that extra little bit of lemon juice you could put into a second beverage while you take a couple limes and squeeze those into different beverages. Because part of CXL 2.0 and that whole switching and that whole idea is that you could actually take logical devices that are portions of a physical device and spread them among multiple both devices, and also you could utilize them by host processors as well, which are our tacos. And so at this point, you're probably wondering what the heck those lemons are. Well, those lemons don't necessarily have to be just DDR5 memory. We're going to be on DDR5 basically when CXL comes out. They could also be other types of memory. We could, in theory, have a CXL memory controller and a CXL controller that uses GDDR6X, for example. Or we could, in theory, I guess, have an HBM one. And another option is that we could have persistent memory. So we could have something like 3D XPoint, which is Intel Optane persistent memory right now. But also there will be new types of storage class memory that will come out. We could potentially have those be on a CXL controller and then have those available for different devices. And so the reason that we have lemons and the lime there is really just to show the idea that you don't necessarily only have to have memory involved in this. You could also have different types of media that are on CXL controllers, and that allows you to do some really interesting things, because now if I want to have persistent memory, I don't have to just have that attached and accessible by the host CPU. I can have that memory, that storage class memory, accessible by any device and the host processors in a system. We recently covered the idea that Micron is abandoning their, I guess, push for using 3D XPoint in DIMM slots, instead favoring the really CXL type of implementations and storage class memory in that space. And this is really why, because, well, that is a much more flexible model. And in the same way that having a lime for your beverage is always nice, it also is kind of nice to have the choice and the ability to use whichever kinds of citrus fruit that you want to go use. So what I want to do is kind of leave you with an example. And really, this is just kind of a mental model to think about, well, what could the implications of this be? And why is this going to be such a big deal for servers? We've really talked mostly about provisioning resources to specific hosts or devices, but let's take something that is falling out of favor, let's face it these days, which is the RAID controller. And if you look at a hardware RAID controller today, you're going to see a couple common things. You're going to see a SoC, which does all the parity calculations, also manages where all the data moves, and has your connection back to the host system. On most higher-end RAID controllers, you're going to have onboard DRAM cache. And the idea behind the DRAM cache is that you could either cache reads or writes in that DRAM cache to make access much faster than having to go all the way to disks. But because that DRAM cache is volatile, what you also need is you need something to provide power loss protection to that RAID controller. And so usually you have a capacitor or you have a battery backup unit, and often those are service parts. Sometimes you also have onboard flash. So that way, if there is a power loss event where you are using the charge from those capacitors or the battery, you have a place to write that, and that is really your flash-backed write cache. And then attached to the RAID controller, you'll often have SSDs, that sometimes the storage controller is actually using those as cache. And then you may have disks as well. So there's a whole lot going on in that idea of a modern RAID controller, but that can totally change with all of this new CXL technology. So imagine the future where you have DRAM-less NAND SSDs, because, well, you don't need DRAM. The SSD controller can potentially use the memory on the host processor or just this pool of memory that we have, say, on a CXL 2.0 switch. And if we get rid of the DRAM on our SSDs, that also means that we don't need the power loss protection on that SSD, which greatly lowers the cost of providing SSDs. I mentioned this is driven by hyperscalers, and they're all about driving costs lower. But of course, especially as we get to QLC NAND and we get to the next generations of NAND, NAND memory and media is getting a little bit slower. So what we need is still some way to do writes very fast, but we also need to be persistent, because that's really what that idea of both the write cache at the RAID controller as well as the write cache on the drives can potentially fix. So in that example, well, we could actually use a CXL storage class memory device. So in just kind of today's terms, you could think of 3D XPoint or Intel Optane persistent memory, or an Optane SSD. And that could actually be our super fast write cache. Then let's go totally crazy. And what if you had a coprocessor like a DPU? And what if that DPU was really the storage gateway instead of a RAID controller? That DPU could manage the flushing of the persistent memory that's in the system, and you could manage, you know, to put it onto a NAND SSD, or it could also manage putting the data from that persistent cache into, say, network storage. But the flip side to that is not only do we get some savings because we don't necessarily need to have as many bits of DRAM, but we also get the flip side to it. A RAID controller only typically has a couple of gigabytes of memory, but, well, maybe we need more memory than just a couple gigabytes. And now with CXL, we'd have a availability of memory in a system to go have more than that, even though we don't necessarily put as much local memory on the device. And so this type of model, if you just kind of take and just kind of think through what's going on there, that's really a really good example of how CXL can be completely transformational. The way that computer architecture and server architecture will be when we go forward a couple of years is going to be completely different than what we have today. And one of the big reasons of that is that we have all these new kinds of capabilities in a system. We're no longer limited to where the memory naturally resides. It could be almost anywhere. For absolute years, we have been talking about the idea of having, you know, a shelf of memory, a shelf of compute, a shelf of storage, maybe having a shelf of accelerators, and then having that disaggregated and composable infrastructure. And CXL is one of the ways that we're going to get there. Whereas we've been talking about that model for years, CXL is not a theoretical exercise. CXL is in the next generation of servers. Now, we're going to have to wait another generation or two till we get CXL 2.0. But at the same time, we're really starting to see that transition because the technology is coming into place. CXL 1.1, when we start seeing devices based on that, we're most likely going to see those devices, and those are really going to start priming the ecosystem because there is a lot of software work that will go behind this. But at the same time, this is a fundamental technology that you need to understand. I've given the example of tacos, beverages, and limes, but there are definitely other options to explain it. If you're watching this video, then here's the deal. You definitely need to start having the conversations with your coworkers and maybe your customers, or, you know, anybody that you interact with in terms of servers. And you really need to start having those discussions on how will this impact our infrastructure when this type of model comes to be. For the next couple months, we're basically in the server realm where everybody knows this is coming, but at the same time, they need to sell servers today, so they're not really talking about it too much, but it is going to be one of the biggest driving factors in upgrade cycles starting in 2022 and beyond. I genuinely think this is going to be like a BCAD era type thing, which is kind of before CXL and after CXL, I guess. I don't know what AD would be in there. Maybe it's AC after CXL. Now, we've talked about PCIe Gen 5 here, but the industry definitely is thinking about PCIe Gen 6 and beyond, because once this comes to be and we have all the CXL switching and some of the newer features and later features, there's definitely going to be a need for even lower latencies and higher bandwidth. So CXL will be an application that will drive us to higher speeds on the PCIe side in the future. Now, of course, as more comes out on CXL, we will cover it on STH, but I really wanted this video to be something that you can use to go and reference just kind of as a conceptual model, and also just send it to your friends and share it, because the whole idea of this is that we should be talking about this transition now, so that way we're prepared for it when it comes in only a couple quarters. Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed this video, and thank you for indulging me if you've made it this far in using these limes. I just kind of challenged myself to think of how I could explain CXL and limes, and this is what I came up with. It definitely wasn't perfect, but hopefully you learned something in the process. And if you did learn something, well, why don't you share this video with someone who may benefit from it, but also give us a like, click subscribe, and turn on those notifications so you can see whenever we come out with great new videos. We're definitely going to be covering CXL. As always, thanks for watching. Have an awesome day.